Welcome to the Shepherd's Chapel Network Family Bible Study Hour with Pastor Dennis Murray. Wisdom is understanding God's Word. Pastor Murray's unique teaching approach brings God's Word alive with meaning as he takes you on a chapter-by-chapter, verse-by-verse study of God's letter to you, the Bible. And now, here is Pastor Dennis Murray.
Good day to you. God bless you. Welcome to Shepherd's Chapel. Welcome to this Family Bible Study Hour. Ready to get back into our Father's Word here at the chapel? We invite you to get your Bible and join us if you care to. We're going to pick it up today, 1 Kings chapter 12, verse 17. In our last lecture, we saw Rehoboam, the son of Solomon, gather all of Israel to Shechem. And, of course, his intent was that they were going to anoint him king over all of Israel. And they said, well, let's talk about this a minute. The people of the 10 tribes to the north said, before we anoint you king, we'd like to hear you say that, yes, my father put heavy burdens, a heavy yoke on you, and I'm going to lighten your yoke. And of course, Rehoboam said, well, let me think about it 3 days and I'll get back with you. And so during that 3 days, he went and he consulted with the elder advisors, many of whom were counselors to his father David or his grandfather David and descendants of David's counselors. And they said, well, you know, if you would lighten their yoke a little bit and you speak nicely to them rather than as a tyrant, like you have been addressing them and your father Solomon did, then they'll serve you. He rejected their counsel, and he went with the counsel of his young schoolmates who were, felt young and invincible. They're the ones that counseled him, you know, your little finger is stronger and more powerful than the loins of your father Solomon. And he chastised you with whips. I'm going to chastise you with scorpions, which is whips with metal cleats on the end of each strap of leather. Well, the people of Israel weren't real happy with that. They said, you know, what portion or what allotment do we have with the house of David, with Judah, in other words, and they all went home. That's when the stick, the one nation of Israel, was broken into two sticks. And it's that way until today. And if you don't know that, you're missing a lot of God's word. You have the house of Judah and you have the house of Israel, referring to the 10 tribes to the north. So we're going to pick it up today with the nation just having split and the people of Israel are about to anoint Jeroboam the king over the 10 tribes to the north. Which, you know, that was God's plan. We learned that in chapter 11 when Ahijah the prophet was sent to Jeroboam and he took his garment, his cloak off, you remember, and they tore it into 12 pieces. And Ahijah the prophet said, you take 10, Jeroboam, each one of those pieces, of course, being symbolic of one of the tribes of Israel. So that's where we pick it up today. Let's ask that word of wisdom in Yeshua Jesus' precious name, Father, we ask you to open eyes, open ears this day. 1 Kings chapter 12, verse 17, and it reads, but as for the children of Israel, which dwelt in the cities of Judah, Rehoboam reigned over them. Now, this is talking about people who were born in one of the 10 tribes to the north, but they or their family or both had relocated and were residing in Judah or Benjamin. In that case, Rehoboam remained their king, is what this is talking about. Verse 18, then King Rehoboam, the king of Judah, Solomon's son, sent Adoram, who was over the tribute. He was the tax collector. And all Israel stoned him with stones that he died. Therefore, King Rehoboam made speed to get him up to his chariot to flee to Jerusalem. Well, that wasn't very smart. After the nation was split, to immediately turn around and send a tax collector to gather taxes for to be sent back to Jerusalem. They should have known how he was going to be received. Jeroboam had the Israelites stirred up, and they are already madder than a wet hornet. And now they further complicate things by sending a tax collector. Rehoboam, it sounds like, barely escaped with his life. Verse 19, so Israel rebelled against the house of David unto this day. And not only to this day, meaning the day that this was written, but to this day here at this point in time. The two sticks will be rejoined together, as it's written in Ezekiel chapter 37. I look forward to when that happens, because Jesus Christ is here with us when it does. Verse 20, and it came to pass, when all Israel heard that Jeroboam was come again, in other words, he'd been in Egypt, where he fled for his life because Solomon was trying to kill him, that they sent and called him unto the congregation, and made him king over Israel. There was none that followed the house of David, but the tribe of Judah only. And of course, the Benjamites stuck with Judah. But Jeroboam, the king over Israel now. And you know, I can't help but believe that God was kind of chuckling at this point to himself. He had to be a little bit. You know, he wanted to be the king. Our Heavenly Father wanted to be the king of Israel. No, they had to have a man king that they could see, like the other heathen nations of the world. Well, now they not only have one man king, I wonder how they're going to like having two men kings. Again, I'm sure God was chuckling. 21. And when Rehoboam was come to Jerusalem from trying to collect taxes, he assembled all the house of Judah with the tribe of Benjamin, 144,000 chosen men. He's mustering the troops. He's mad, which were warriors to fight against the house of Israel to bring the kingdom again to Rehoboam, the son of Solomon, 180,000 soldiers that he was able to muster. And what's a considerable army for sure, but you can be assured that the army of Israel, that they would be able to muster, being 10 tribes rather than two tribes, Judah would have been greatly outnumbered. But this was not in God's plan. Once again, we see Rehoboam taking off with his own agenda. Did he go before the priest and ask them to inquire of the Lord what he should do? No, he took off on his own. But it was God's plan that the nation would be split. And he told Solomon, because of your idolatry and your worshiping the gods of your foreign wives, I'm going to rip 10 of the tribes away from your seed, your posterity, your children. And I tell you, you don't ever want to go against God's plan. If you go against God's plan, I guarantee you're going to lose. Verse 22. But the word of God came unto Shemaiah, the man of God, saying, Shemaiah means Yah has heard. And the Lord definitely had heard what was going on with Rehoboam, and he was not happy at all. Verse 23, Rehoboam had not sought God's counsel to this point, but he's about to get some advice from God. Speak unto Rehoboam, the son of Solomon, king of Judah, underlined Judah. He was going to be the king of all Israel, but not in God's eyes. He was the king of Judah. And unto all the house of Judah and Benjamin, and to the remnant of the people, saying, a remnant of the people, were the verse we covered today, verse 17, those who were born of Israel, but were residing among the tribes, the geographical location of Judah and Benjamin. in Chronicles, this verse reads, and to all Israel in Judah. 24. Thus saith the Lord, ye shall not go up nor fight against your brethren, the children of Israel. Return every man to his house, for this thing is from me, the Lord speaking. They hearkened or listened, therefore, to the word of the Lord and returned to depart, in other words, from going against Israel, according to the word of the Lord. They obeyed the word of the Lord. That's always a good thing to do. You know, God does not like brother fighting brother. He doesn't like civil war. You remember when Israel was coming out of Egypt, on more than one occasion, they wanted to cross the land of the Edomites, and then another occasion, the land of the Moabites. And they sent word to the king of Edom and the king of Moab, you know, let us pass through your land. We won't turn to the left, we won't turn to the right. If we drink any of your water, we'll pay you for it. If we eat any of your food, we'll pay you for it. Just all we want to do is pass through your land. Well, they felt threatened and wouldn't let Israel pass through. And the Israelites asked God, can we smite them with the sword? And God said, no. He forbid them from fighting among their brothers. Why? Because they were their brothers. They were Adamic peoples. Did they worship Yahweh? No, they didn't. They worshiped heathen gods. But again, God does not like brother fighting against brother. 25. Then Jeroboam built or rebuilt or fortified Shechem. Shechem had been around for centuries. He didn't build it from scratch. In Mount Ephraim, this would later become his capital, and dwelt therein, and went out from thence and built or fortified Penuel. Now Shechem is on the west side of Jordan. Penuel, on the other, is on the east side of Jordan. 26. And Jeroboam said in his heart, this is said in his mind, in other words, he said this to himself, now shall the kingdom return to the house of David. Now wait a minute. God sent a prophet, Ahijah, to Jeroboam to tell him he was going to be the king of the 10 tribes. The people anointed him king over the 10 tribes. Now he's thinking the people are going to rebel against him and return to Rehoboam. He's a little bit paranoid here. He's thinking for himself. And what's going on here is, you see, he doesn't believe God. He doesn't trust God. He doesn't have any confidence in our Heavenly Father. 27. If this people go up to do sacrifice in the house of the Lord at Jerusalem, then shall the heart or the mind of this people turn again unto their Lord, note the small L, even unto Rehoboam, king of Judah. And they shall kill me and go again to Rehoboam, king of Judah. Jeroboam being a doubter, excuse me, of God's word here. And he's even, I'm going to say, a bit paranoid, and then that he thinks that the people are going to kill him. Verse 28. Whereupon the king took counsel, not with God, I'll add, and made two calves of gold, and said unto them, the people of the 10 tribes to the north, it is too much for you to go up to Jerusalem. Behold thy gods, O Israel, which brought thee up out of the land of Egypt. Now, this is pretty serious what he's doing. He's encouraging the people of the 10 tribes to commit idolatry. He's saying, you know, you don't need to go down to Jerusalem, which is located in Judah, and worship You see, he's afraid if they go down there, they'll pledge allegiance to Rehoboam. But here are your gods. Behold your gods. And you know what? They probably hadn't even cooled from being melted down and to be poured into the forms. And he's saying, behold your gods that brought your ancestors out of the land of Egypt. 29. And he set the one in Bethel, house of God. What a joke. And the other put he in Dan. He's making it very convenient for the people to worship the golden calves. You know, no need for anybody to travel any great distance. You don't even have to come to Shechem. I'm going to put one in Bethel and one in Dan, so no one will have to be too greatly inconvenience to go and make offerings to the golden calf. I wonder if Jeroboam was familiar with Exodus chapter 32, where when Moses had gone up on Sinai to receive the Ten Commandments, and when he came down, what did he find? He found Aaron, his own brother, the high priest, and the people had made a golden calf to worship. And evidently he didn't know the outcome of that. Verse 30. And this thing became a sin, for the people went to worship before the one, even unto Dan. Now this is a bad translation. What is saying in verse 29, they went to Bethel and worshiped, and then in verse 30, they also went to Dan and worshiped. And this is, like I said, this is idolatry, worshiping a golden calf. And when you commit idolatry and sin against our Father this way, you can bet there's trouble on the horizon. Verse 31, and he, this is Jeroboam, made an house of high places, made his own temple, and made priest of the lowest of the people, just anyone will do, which were not of the sons of Levi. You know, God appoints priests, and he called the house of Levi to minister unto him. You see, the problem for Jeroboam is, though, that as soon as he made the golden calves, the Levites and anyone else that had a righteous bone in their body headed south. And I don't mean they started downhill. I mean they were going south to Judah and relocating because they knew what would happen. You know, as the leader of a nation goes, usually so goes the nation. And anyone, like I said, with a righteous bone in their body knew things were not looking good for the 10 tribes to the north when they saw the two golden calves. But and because the Levites were gone, Jeroboam would take anyone who wanted to wear a religious-looking robe and act holier than thou. He would fill their hand, which is a term that means he would consecrate them into the priesthood of Jeroboam. And Jeroboam ordained, he's not through yet, and Jeroboam ordained a feast in the eighth month on the 15th day of the month. And this is not a feast appointed by God, like unto the feast that is in Judah. And he offered upon the altar, so did he in Bethel, sacrificing unto the calves that he had made. And he placed in Bethel the priest of the high places which he had made. He's playing church. He's making up his own religion as he goes. He's afraid that the people are going to go to Jerusalem to worship Yahweh, and their loyalty, their allegiance, would not be with him, but with Rehoboam. So what does he do? He makes two golden calves for them to worship so they don't have to go to Jerusalem. He makes his own priests that no doubt reported directly to him and followed his instructions, not God's instructions. Then he goes so far as to make a feast like the feast that Israel, Judah would have in the seventh month, the 15th day, Sukkoth, the Feast of Tabernacles. And that's just the way things were going. He's playing church, making up his rules as he goes, creating a new religion, the house of Jeroboam, verse 33. So he offered upon the altar to the golden calves, which he had made in Bethel the 15th day of the 8th month, even in the month which he had devised of his own heart, his own mind, and ordained a feast unto the children of Israel, and he offered upon the altar and burnt incense himself. Here he's taking on the role of the priest. You remember a guy by the name of Korah who tried to take the priesthood away from Aaron and the leadership of the nation away from Moses? And he said, you know, Aaron, you and Moses take too much upon yourself. The people of Israel are holy. And Moses said, if the people of Israel are so holy, you and your priest meet us down at the temple and we'll offer incense and see who is holy and who is not. Well, the 250 with Korah, it got so hot they disappeared. I mean, it just turned them to ashes and melted their little censers. God made it very clear who was to be his priesthood. And, you know, God is not, and then the earth opened her mouth and swallowed Korah and his troop. You know, God promised Jeroboam a long and lengthy succession to the throne if he would follow God's commandments. Not only is he not following God's commandments, he's making up his own commandments as he goes. God's not going to put up with it. The seed of Jeroboam will be cut off completely. Chapter 13, the warning given to Jeroboam, and we also have the disobedient prophet. Chapter 13, verse 1. And behold, there came a man of God out of Judah by the word of the Lord unto Bethel, where the golden calf was, remember? And Jeroboam stood by the altar to burn incense, acting like a priest himself. Now this was a true prophet, a true man of God out of Judah. And remember, I'd said anybody that had a righteous bone in their body had fled Israel into Judah at this point in time. Verse 2, and he, the man of God, the prophet, cried against the altar in the word of the Lord, and said, O altar, altar, thus saith the Lord, behold, a child shall be born unto the house of David, of the tribe of Judah, Josiah by name, and upon thee shall he offer the priest of the high places that burn incense upon thee, and men's bones shall be burnt upon thee. This one Josiah, born some 360 years following this event. 2 Kings chapter 23, verse 15 and 16. And by offering the bones of the idolatrous priests on this fake altar at Bethel to the golden calves, where sacrifice was made to the golden calves, he, by pouring the ashes of the idolatrous priest on the altar, it would desecrate it and keep anyone else from using this altar. That's God's future judgment. He's going to be giving an immediate judgment, and the altar in front of Jeroboam is going to be rent in two and the ashes poured out by Yahweh himself. Verse 3, and he, the true prophet, gave a sign the same day, saying, this is the sign which the Lord hath spoken. Behold, the altar shall be rent, and the ashes that are upon it shall be poured out, desecrating the altar from service being performed on it. In other words, the prophet saying, this judgment is immediately going to come to pass. This altar is going to be rent in two. And it came to pass, when King Jeroboam heard the saying of the man of God, which he had cried against the altar in Bethel, he put forth his hand from the altar, saying, lay hold on him. And his hand, this is Jeroboam's, which he put forth against him, dried up so that he could not pull it in again to himself. The hand of Jeroboam withered and paralyzed. Again, instant judgment. This is one of 11 cases recorded in the Bible where a ruler dared to put forth his hand against a prophet of God. You see, God sent the prophets to the kings trying to get their attention, trying to straighten them out. And what happened? Well, God said, touch not mine anointed, and he meant it. Jeroboam now has a crippled hand. Verse 5. The altar also was rent. That means it came apart, torn in two. And we're talking stones, rock here. And the ashes poured out from the altar, according to the sign which the man of God had given by the word of the Lord. Josiah would come some 360 years later, although now immediate judgment passed on this altar and Jeroboam. Now, what could have caused this altar to be rent in two and the ashes poured out? Well, God controls nature. I'm going to say it was probably an earthquake. And we might ask, well, why Josiah? Why 360 years later? Well, God, I think time to our Heavenly Father is really irrelevant. He states, Peter wrote in 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 8, be not ignorant that one day with the Lord is as 1,000 years, and 1,000 years as one day. 360 years to our Heavenly Father, not much time. And again, it's really irrelevant. Verse 6. And the king, and this is Jeroboam, answered and said unto the man of God, entreat now the face of the Lord thy God. Notice he didn't dare say my God. And pray for me that my hand may be restored me again. And the man of God besought the Lord, and the king's hand was restored him again and became as it was before. Well, let me ask you now, if that all happened to you, would it straighten you out? Well, I believe it would straighten me out. And we learn from this too, that a man of God can bring down the wrath of God, or he can entreat God for a healing. Both have happened in the last couple of verses. Verse 7. And the king, this is Jeroboam, said unto the man of God, come home with me and refresh thyself, and I will give thee a reward. Note, there's no indication that he was forcing the man of God at this point. The king saying, well, come on over to my place and let me show my appreciation for you entreating the Lord to repair my paralyzed hand. And while you're there, I'll open up my treasuries and give you a reward. Verse 8. And the man of God said unto the king, if thou wilt give me half thine house, I will not go in with thee, neither will I eat bread nor drink water in this place. Rejection of Jeroboam's worship of the Lord. This half thine house, I think the man of God remembering Balaam's words, of Balak in Numbers chapter 22 and 24. You see, Balak tried to hire Balaam to curse Israel. And Balaam said, if you give me half of your house filled with silver, I cannot go against the word of God. Verse 9. For so it was charged me, the man of God continues speaking, by the word of the Lord, saying, eat no bread, nor drink water, nor turn again by the same way that thou camest. When you've accomplished what your mission was, you don't drink bread, drink water there, you don't eat bread there. And when you come home by a different way than what you went. In other words, the people could be looking for you. Also in 1 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 11, we learn that we should not break bread with idolaters. Our bread is not their bread. Our living water is not their water. Verse 10. So he went another way and returned not by the way that he came to Bethel. So far, the disobedient servant, the disobedient prophet, as he's called, is doing exactly as God instructed. There's a reason he's called the disobedient prophet, though, and we're about to find out why. Verse 11. Now there dwelt an old prophet in Bethel. A true prophet of God would not have been in Bethel at this time. Anyone, as I've said three times now, with a righteous bone in their body, had fled Israel and was residing in Judah. And his sons came and told him all the works that the man of God had done that day in Bethel, the words which he had spoken unto the king. Them they told also to their father. And they probably told him, we heard this man say that there would be a child born 360 years later, and that this altar that to the golden calf was going to be rent in half and the ashes poured out on the ground. And then the king, Jeroboam, reached forth his hand to stop the prophet from rending that altar in two. And the king drew back his hand, and it was withered and paralyzed. And all of these things happened, and the old man, the false prophet's taking it all in. He's probably thinking, well, maybe he, what does this man know about this future child being born? What does he know about the future that I might be able to utilize? Well, he's going to track down the true prophet of God, and it's unbelievable what happens next. We've got a short message. We'll ask you to listen a moment, won't you please?
The Mark of the Beast on CD is our free introductory offer to you. What is the Mark of the Beast? Many false teachers would have you believe it will be a tattoo on your forehead or a computer chip implanted under your skin. It's getting late in the game. You need to know what the Mark of the Beast is. As it's written in Revelation chapter 13, verse 8, many will be deceived. Christ said in Mark 13, 23, behold, I have foretold you all things. Jesus indeed told us how not to be deceived, and Pastor Arnold Murray takes you on a step-by-step study of God's Word concerning this critical subject. The telephone call is free, the CD is free, no shipping and handling. Just call 800-643-4645 to request your one-time, one-per-household copy of The Mark of the Beast. You may also mail your request to Shepherd's Chapel, P.O. Box 416, Gravette, Arkansas, 72736. Don't be deceived by Satan.
Welcome back. We're glad you could join back with us. Let's have the 800 number, please. 800-643-4645. That number good throughout Puerto Rico, the U.S., and Canada. If you have a biblical question that you'd like to pose to be answered on the air, feel free to call that number and leave your question. Please don't ask questions about a specific individual, denomination, or organization by name. We teach God's Word in a positive manner, throwing out negative about others, especially our brothers and sisters in Christ, serves no purpose. We simply won't do it. We'll let God's Word do the teaching, the correcting, and the healing, fully capable of all three. If you're listening via shortwave radio or studying via the internet somewhere around the world that's unable to use that 800 number, your announcer at the end of the hour will give you our mailing address. Quite all right to mail your questions in. Got a prayer request? Well, we can do away with the 800 number. You don't need a telephone. You don't need paper and pencil and a mailing address. Your Heavenly Father is there for you 24/7. I encourage you to make time each day, at least once through the day, to talk to your Heavenly Father. And you should be able to talk to Him just like He's your flesh father. He's the closest relative that you have. And I don't think you have a lot of competition these days. It seems like everyone is living in such a fast-paced world that they don't have time for our Father. I'm sure that hurts His feelings. That's why it's so important, and when you talk to Him, the blessings follow. We do have these prayer requests, Father. We ask, come to You in the name of Your Son, Jesus Christ. We ask You to look upon these, Father. You know their needs, marital problems, financial difficulties, Father. You know if it is Your will, a special blessing on each of these. We also lift up our military troops who are in harm's way around the world. Watch over, guide, direct, touch, protect in Jesus' precious name. Amen and thank you, Father. All right, let's get to some questions, see what's on the mind of folks. Jimmy in Texas, do you believe in the Trinity? Well, if you watch this program any length of time, you would definitely hear us teaching the Father, the Son, Jesus Christ, and the Holy Spirit, which is, of course, the Spirit of our Heavenly Father. Yes, we teach the Trinity. We baptize in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Anthony in Illinois, I know when Christ died, He left the Holy Spirit, but if you're doing evil or sinning, is the Holy Spirit still always with you? No, Jesus promised the Comforter, which is the Holy Spirit, on condition in John chapter 14, verse 15. He said, if you love Me and keep My commandments, I will pray the Father give you the Comforter that He may abide with you forever. That's a condition. If you love Me and follow My commandments. If you don't love Him and you don't follow His commandments, you can't expect the Holy Spirit to reside with you. Lee in California, what does the Word mean when it says in the end times they will say peace, peace, peace? They are saying this now. Does this mean we should not say this? No, there's nothing wrong with saying peace, peace, peace. In Matthew 24, though, and the subject of Matthew 24 is what? It's what is it going to be like? What are the events that are going to be coming to pass just prior and leading up to the return of Jesus Christ? In Matthew 24:6, Christ says, "Ye shall, when you hear of wars and rumors of wars, be not ye troubled, for these things must come to pass, but the end is not yet." And I tell you, we're hearing plenty about wars and rumors of wars around the world at this very time. But we also hear, as you said, the drumbeat of peace, peace, peace. You know, the United Nations, the IMF, the International Monetary Fund, the European Union, all of these things are coming to about, and they point to one thing, and that's one worldism. One worldism is the first beast, the political beast, of Revelation chapter 13. So, yeah, when you hear peace, 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 you better start perking your ears up because the end could be near. And when we say the end, we're not talking about the end of the world. We're talking about the end of one period of time, and what happens when one period of time ends, the next period of time starts. We're talking about ages not worlds. Cordelia, I hope I'm pronouncing that right, or it was written right, in California. I was baptized in a church that didn't believe in Jesus Christ, but I want to be baptized in a church that does. Can I be baptized again? If you weren't baptized in the name of Jesus Christ, I would certainly recommend that you be baptized in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. You know, there's only one, what I would call, concern about being baptized more than one time. If you had said, Cordelia, that you were baptized in the name of Jesus Christ in this church, other than the church you belong to now, and you want to be baptized again, I would be quick to point out Hebrews chapter 6, verses 5 and 6, where Paul is teaching that, you know, once you come to knowledge, once you believe and you're baptized, and then you fall away and you sin, but don't then think that it's necessary to re-crucify Christ. Once on the cross was enough. And what you need to do in that case is repent, because he did the job for you to be saved. It's you who fell short by falling away and sinning again. So once you're baptized in the name of Jesus Christ, don't re-crucify him on the cross by thinking you need to be saved and baptized again. Simply repent. Irvin in South Carolina, please explain 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verses 6 and 7. And that's confusing verses for many that haven't been taught correctly. And of course, there in chapter 2 of 2 Thessalonians, Paul is teaching us what it's going to be like prior to the return of Jesus Christ. And he tells us there in the first few verses of chapter 2 that Christ is not going to return except there first come a great falling away, an apostasy in the Greek language. And that man of sin, that's Antichrist, Satan in his role as Antichrist, be revealed. Then in verse 6 it goes on to say, and now ye know what withholdeth, that he might be revealed in his time. And then in verse 7, only he who now letteth will let until he be taken out of the way. That verb letteth in verse 7 is a transitive verb, and it means that you have to transfer the action back to the subject of the previous verse. He who holdeth is, of course, Michael, and Michael is holding Satan in heaven. Can I document that biblically? You bet I can. Revelation chapter 12, verse 6, and the following verses. And Michael and his angels, the archangel, and Satan and his angels war. And Michael prevails and boots Satan and his angels out onto earth. That's when he's here in his role as Antichrist. Glenn from New Jersey, and thank you for your kind comment and remembering our staff. Question, how does Matthew 25, 41 through 46 on eternal punishment square up to the consumer fire teaching? Well, again, Matthew 25 there, where that you're talking about, has to do with the return. Oh, you said 25, and I was thinking Matthew 24, because I just had a previous question on 24. So I'm going to put that one aside, and I promise you, Glenn, will address it first thing tomorrow, because I was looking at the wrong chapter. That goes to show that I'm human, and I mess up, and I apologize, but we'll get an answer. George in Tennessee, God bless you and your staff for blessing all of us with a great Bible study. I am 68 years old and a disabled veteran, and thank you for serving our country. Now also have stage 4 lung and liver cancer. Your prayers for me and my family will be greatly appreciated. You're in our prayers. It is such a blessing to get up in the morning at 5 a.m. and have Bible study with you. It is really increasing my understanding of God's Word. I don't have a question, but please share this testimony with your viewers, such as if you please. And I do please, and God bless you, and thank you for again for serving our country in the military. You're in our prayers for that stage 4 cancer as well. I know somebody who has the power to cure you, if that is his will. That will be our prayer. Canary in Georgia, I am an African American. Can I still be one of God's elect? I follow your teaching and try to do the very best I can to do God's will. Thanks for your teaching. Well, you're sure welcome. It's a labor of love, believe me. Canary, as you study with the chapel, you're going to learn that there are members of other races who are called the kings and queens of the nations, and the Greek ethnos, ethnic peoples, in other words. You can read about those kings in Revelation chapter 21, verse 24 and 25, and that's where it's talking about the temple in the millennium. And you know, God's elect have a right to come and go to that temple as they choose. There's another group of people who have the right to go into the temple as they choose as well. They're called the kings of the nations, and they have the same exact privileges as God's election. Gary in Nevada, Revelation 4:4, it states there that there are 24 elders sitting around the throne. Who are these 24? And why 24? Well, God said 24, so that's good enough for me. It's not written, but I believe that the 12 patriarchs, the namesakes for each of the 12 tribes of Israel, if you will, Reuben, Judah, Gad, Issachar, so on, and the 12 apostles of Jesus Christ, excuse me, make up the 24. Anita in California. On more than one occasion, I have backslid. My question is, will God allow me to try once again to do what is necessary to enter his kingdom? I know that we are in the last days in time to choose whom you will serve. I don't want to enter the second death. Please bless me with the knowledge of God's direction. Well, Anita, let me answer your question by telling you that we all disappoint God from time to time. We all fall short. We all sin. And when we backslide, the thing to do is to repent. And no, it's not too late. You can repent as often as need be. Just be sure and repent often. Continue to try and do the best that you can. Sandra in Ohio. Pastor Arnold said he thought the ark went with Elijah. What was behind the veil that was rent when Christ died on the cross? Was it an empty room where the high priest went to seek the Lord? Well, Sandra, you're a little bit confused. You see, the Ark of the Covenant was God's throne. And in other words, God was present. He was there in the Holy of Holies. But when the ark went with Elijah, and I believe that as well, when the whirlwind took Elijah up, I think the Ark of the Covenant went with it. We read about the ark is in heaven now in Revelation chapter 11, the last verse. I believe it's 19. But the ark nor God are there in the Holy of Holies now. And the veil that separated the Holy of Holies from the rest of the temple and the inner court and the outer court is not there anymore. The veil that Christ rent from top to bottom, meaning from heaven to earth, was the veil that kept us from approaching God. we can approach God. We can walk right on into that holy place now and seek the Lord ourselves in the name of Jesus Christ. So the veil is not there. The actual Holy of Holies is not there any longer. Excuse me. The veil was what between heaven and earth. Bill in Massachusetts, I only have one question. And it is to what has been told to me that Noah's three sons were three different races. Now, let me ask you, Bill, does that sound logical to you that Noah's sons, you see, Noah and his wife had three sons. Does it sound logical that they would be different races? You see, that's not biologically possible. So that's not true. The different races were created in Genesis chapter 1 when God said to the angels, let us make man in our image. And at the end of chapter 1, he looked on all that he made and he was pleased. He said it was good. Then he rested, Genesis chapter 2, the seventh day, but then he created another man, Eth Ha'adam, in the Hebrew languages, the mad Adam from which Eve was taken from him. But that's where the races came from. It's impossible to have races come from Adam and Eve, the first couple, which a lot of people misteach. Adam and Eve weren't the first people on earth. The races that were created on the sixth day were. Edith in New Hampshire, why was God displeased with Cain? This was before Cain did anything. Well, in Genesis chapter 4, verse 3, Cain brought his offering to the Lord. But you see, it wasn't first fruits. First fruits also indicate love. And Cain didn't love our Heavenly Father. And in verse 5, it states that Abel brought the firstlings of the flock. You see, that is first fruits, and that is love. And you see, God did not approve of Cain's offering. And when Cain saw that, his countenance fell. He got very angry at God and also his brother Abel. Jealousy, in other words. What happened next? Well, Cain murdered his brother Abel. God didn't respect Cain's offering, and again, he slew his brother, which even further angered our Heavenly Father. Patty in California, and I'm an old disabled lady and an honorably discharged U.S. Army veteran. Please, peace and God bless the USA. Well, and thank you for serving our country. And this is from Patty in California. I do not want to knock anyone's socks off in spreading the living word, but when I looked up humor in my concordance, it was not there. Should I look up the words folly, fool, or another instead? I need to teach with lightness. Okay, well, you know, and there's nothing wrong with teaching God having a sense of humor, because he most assuredly has to have a sense of humor. Can you imagine sitting up in heaven and looking down as you use the word folly at the folly that goes on earth? He'd have to have a sense of humor. In the Old Testament, try the word mirth, M-I-R-T-H, and look that up in your Strongs. You'll find that it's simcha in the Hebrew language, and it means glee. It's also translated joy, pleasure, and rejoice. But one example that we'll get to in 1 Kings toward the end of it, that is a witness that God has a sense of humor, is when Elijah was going up against the 450 Baal prophets of Jezebel and Ahab, and he said, okay, well, we're going to get two oxes. You take one of the oxes, I'll take the other. and you guys build a fire, and then I'll build a fire, and we'll see, an altar, and see which one God sends fire down. Well, the 450 prophets of Baal, they built their altar, and they jumped up and down, and they cut themselves, and they beat themselves for almost a whole day, and there was no fire came down from heaven. And Elijah said, you know, maybe your God is on vacation, or maybe he needed a potty break. Now, that to me, that's showing that our Father has a sense of humor. Of course, that's when Elijah instructed them to pour tons of water on his sacrifice, and then the fire of God came down and consumed it off of the altar. Patty in California, this is our veteran again. I cannot find your CD teachings on death or dying of older Christians to speak to them to help in their transition. What do I look up to aid those to keep their joy, happiness, and laughter in God/Jesus' name? Please lead me. Thanks, and great thanks. Well, you might consider ordering 30475, Where Are the Dead? Most people find comfort in that study of knowing where they go when they pass away. And again, Glenn from New Jersey, I'll get back with you first thing up tomorrow on Matthew 25. I'm out of time. I love you all. Why? Because you enjoy studying our Father's Word in depth. And you know what? It makes His day, and blessings follow. We are brought to you by your tithes and offerings. If we've helped you, help us keep coming to you and to reach out to others who are lost in this world of darkness. Most important this, though, beloved, you stay in His Word every day. Every day in your Heavenly Father's Word is a good day, even with trouble. You know why? It's because Jesus Yeshua is the living Word.
Hearing God's Word with understanding will change your life. We hope you have enjoyed studying God's Word here on the Shepherd's Chapel Family Bible Study Hour with Pastor Dennis Murray. If you would like to receive more information concerning Shepherd's Chapel, you may request our free introductory offer. Our introductory offer contains the Mark of the Beast CD, our monthly newsletter with a written Bible study, a CD catalog, and a list of written reference works available through Shepherd's Chapel. To request our free introductory offer by telephone, call 800-643-4645, 24 hours a day. You may also request our introductory offer by writing to Shepherd's Chapel, P.O. Box 416, Gravette, Arkansas, 72736. Once again, that's Shepherd's Chapel, P.O. Box 416, Gravette, Arkansas, 72736. We invite you to join us for the next in-depth Bible study each weekday at the same time. Thank you for watching today's program, and God bless you.
The Book of Ezekiel. What a fantastic study, this book of Ezekiel. The book of Ezekiel that covers, if you would, those vehicles, those circular discs. In the Hebrew, it states very clearly that whirlwind with the color amber traced back to the Hebrew, highly polished bronze. What an exciting thing that God's Word informs us on all things. Ezekiel, one of my favorite prophets of the Bible, probably more written, not probably, but absolutely more written on what will happen in the millennium age than even the book of Revelation. Ezekiel guiding you through it, what God will expect at the final battle, Armageddon and Haman Gog, recorded in this great prophecy. I know you're going to enjoy it, the book of Ezekiel.
Welcome to the Shepherd's Chapel with Pastor Arnold Murray. Open your Bible and let's go to class with Dr. Murray for a better understanding of our Father's Word.
All right, good day to you. God bless you. Welcome to the Shepherd's Chapel. Welcome to this family Bible study. Our praise God, our Father's Word, how precious it is. Test your teachers. That's the title that I chose for two lectures, the past and this one, which will complete the subject for this time. It's important that you test your teachers. A teacher that is really genuine in God's Word wants you to test him. Did you hear what I said? Wants you to. Because a teacher is successful when he has caused someone to study God's Word seriously. Past the milk, past the diaper stage.